And thank you so much, first of all, for such a sweet introduction. I don't know about future, but as of now, I am certainly not an eminent academician. It's like, I think I need to work really a lot to qualify that calling. I would certainly be wishing to become a teacher whom my students hold in good esteem. The dignitaries on the stage, Shri Abu Sheikh Ji, whom all of us just heard and understood, not just through the introduction, but through his inspiring talk. It is my humble submission to this august gathering here, sir, that I honestly wish that academicians, students, teachers, professors, and all the stakeholders, I generally refrain from using the word stakeholders in connection with academics, but the tradition has set it to be like this. If all of us take inspiration from your work and your dedication and your vision into academics, I'm sure what you shared in your speech as your concern for academics, that the center of gravity of the academic policies in our country, the educational policies, unfortunately that center of gravity has shifted elsewhere, so we would definitely be in the near future be able to switch that center of gravity to our own civilization, our consciousness and culture. Thank you very much for the enlightening introductory remarks, sir. On the stage again, my friend Shri Chaitanya Kulkarni Ji, the convener of Prabuddha Bharat, and Shri Sachin Sabnis Ji, and of course, the august gathering here, all of you, friends, professors, academicians, I thank you most humbly and most sincerely, first of all, for securing some time on a busy day, otherwise which you would have shared with your family, and actually making it a point to attend this lecture. I am actually honored by your very presence and your response and all these compliments which have been bestowed upon me, and so on. Before I enter into the topic of the session, a few observations which I made during my musings while I was on my way from Pune to Belgavi about this very place that all of us are located in this present moment. As Indians, we all know that our cultural consciousness is very unique and it is very cliched in one sense. If we look at it from the global perspective, and that is very natural to happen because every civilization will have its own character, which transfers from generation to generation through documents and through culture and so on and so forth. One very peculiar habit of ours in the general sense, all habits generate from our consciousness, as a very peculiar habit of ours, for some reason or other, we are quite fond of extending our feelings and sentiments of obeisance and salutations to something which marks a confluence and convergence and amalgamation of different divergent identities. Our consciousness is not really guided and governed too much by the duality of reality. That's very peculiar about us as Indians, about our consciousness. I'm really feeling prompted to share with you this fact about our consciousness. Doesn't it happen due to our unique consciousness that when different rivers, where they meet, the point where the rivers come at a point of a confluence or a convergence, our ancestors also recognize that, and that is why I have been calling it, it is rooted into our consciousness. I'm sure they were not aware of these contemporary theories and the philosophies and so on and so forth, but all the tirthakshetras, all the places of pilgrimage, there would hardly be a point or a place of a confluence of a river without a temple or a pilgrimage place or something of that sort. What must be the very consciousness, the very idea behind it, that why did they think? Otherwise it's a natural phenomena. One river flows from one direction and then its tributary comes, and then two rivers or different rivers come at a point of confluence. Why establish, build, construct a temple there? And this has been going on since ages, times immemorial. I believe this is some very uncanny, some very, you know, psychological process of extending our sentiments and feelings of devotion to a point or to the tattva of samanvaya, confluence, convergence, something which takes us beyond binaries, dichotomous identities, and something which takes us beyond duality of reality. A river, the confluence of a river marks that point where we go in our consciousness beyond the duality of reality, where different rivers come at a point. I don't know why it happened with me, but all the way during my travel from Pune to Bengaluru, I was constantly getting this image in my mind, and all of a sudden I realized that it becomes all the very significant here to discuss and share this observation with you all, because Belgavi, I believe, marks that point of confluence and convergence of different identities which come together, exist together, and they are shared and they are experienced and they are lived out. Borders in the traditional sense, a border is known to be a point, a special something or a location where two different identities are separated. Can we not think of a border as a point where two different identities come at a meeting point? Can we not think of Belgavi as that cultural tirthakshetra where two different identities come at a point of confluence? Oh my God, culturally I found this idea being very, very relevant. Thanks to all. This is going beyond the dichotomous reality. And you know, interestingly, we need not be trained about this going beyond. We need not be trained about it, because it just flows into our consciousness from generation to generation. Whenever and wherever we happen to think of reality in dualistic manner, we feel that we are broken within. We feel that something is going wrong with reality, and then we soon tend to go beyond that binariness of reality, the dichotomous reality and the duality of reality. Cultural politics in academics as a topic, and my presentation on this is an attempt to share some of my observations which I have made so far with all of you here, with the intention of exposing and again showcasing the trajectory, the path of that anti-Indian academics, especially the anti-Indian academics of humanities, social sciences, language and literary studies, which are trying to inject This dichotomous reality and this duality of identities through these academics of humanities in our universities and colleges and so on and so forth, as it was introduced while the topic of this lecture was introduced here. This is what academics has always been. This is what education has always been to us as Indians. I would like to draw your focus to the last three or four words in this memorable quote by Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, who wasn't only a great poet himself, for being the first Asian to be awarded with the Nobel, but he was also an eminent academician. That is a very sorry state of whatever institution in our country designs the educational policies. That is a very sorry state of affairs in our country that Tagore's views on academics and educations have not been incorporated when the theories and policies of educations were designed by our academicians. In harmony with all existence. This is what academics has always been for us. This is what education has always been for us. In short, life at large flowed into our education in the traditional sense. And the real life as it was lived by the real people with the real value system, it flowed into the education system in the traditional sense. What have we come up to now is that there is an obstruction between education which cannot be identified, being tantamount, being parallel with life at large, and which is the reason what the Honorable Chairperson of this session shared as his one of the concerns in his address was that our education is not on the right road to meet the demands of our society. What a society is made of, after all, it's us, the humans, our values, the values which we live out, our own culture, the culture that we live out, that does not transfer into quote-unquote, the academically palatable content of all those disciplines which assign this position to themselves that they deal with culture and humanities and sociology and political science and so on and so forth. Let me offer a disclaimer here. At times it is possible that some of us might think that I am being xenophobic over here, that I am being somewhat provincial in my approach. I'm not saying that everything that kept coming through the parlors of the West in our academics, that needs to be rejected or that needs to be boycotted. I shall not make an overstatement of that kind, because that would be thoroughly unacademic. What I'm trying to present here as a very humble concern in my capacity as a student and a teacher, because I experience it when I discuss several issues with my students in college, that what they learn from the books and the curriculum which is prescribed for these humanities and what they live out in the society with their families and friends and relatives and their social existence at large, there is hardly any one-to-one correspondence between what they do for their career when they choose these streams for their academic career and what they live out. And this has been going on incessantly since 1947. We became independent politically. We still talk about cultural slavery, we still talk about judicial slavery, we still talk about slavery of so many of our social institutions, and academics, unfortunately, which affects all our lives so deeply, seems to be the most untouched and the most neglected area whatsoever, especially the academics of humanities and social sciences. These were the traditional subjects, as they were called, when we learned social sciences. On the right hand, you see a column which brings a list of the contemporary academics of humanities and so on and so forth. This contemporary, the so-called contemporary academics of humanities had several names. It has a fashionable terminology. It makes itself self-justifiable by the very terminology, by the very logic of it being new, it being contemporary. So the moment it comes to you as contemporary, you are soon compelled to accept it, incorporate it, streamline it into your academics, and then facilitate it for our students, irrespective of whether or not the thought content which we transfer to our students through these kinds of academics, whether or not it is culturally compatible or culturally identifiable to our younger generation or not. The result? Kiss of love protest. New Delhi. A few students from Delhi University and JNU thought that this would be a very effective mode of demonstration, agitation, which would catch the attention of people, and they gathered and they performed their activism. It became a news. It was discussed in our media for a week or so. They thought that they broke the status quo, and they thought that they were changing the society. This is a very sorry state that they do not want really to bring in any change. They definitely want to revolutionize. The poor souls don't recognize that they end up only revolutionizing without any change. These are a few protest drives, the campaigns, the agitation campaigns which were carried out all over the country in several universities, campuses, and so on. There is one common factor of all these agitation drives which took place in several universities, and the common factor being most of these students, if you happen to come across with any such student who ever participated in these agitation drives, ask that student his career in academics. Ask that student what that student is actually learning in colleges. You will find that 9 of the 10 such students who participate in these agitation drives, they will turn out to be the students of humanities, media studies, journalism, film studies, social sciences, language, literature, sociology, political science, this and that. I'm not generally indulging into the negative practice of assaulting them for their agitation, because maybe for my personal reasons, I am not comfortable with them. Sorry, I'm not adopting such a provincial tone over here. My only point of contention is that these people and those who motivate them to carry out such drives, they are really not at all interested into bringing any positive transformation or change in our society. Agitation for the sake of it, reject, revolt, rebel for the sake of it, that is the agenda, because this is all happening again along the lines of the same old idea, ideology and philosophy of Karl Marx and all his successors. And that is why my only humble concern and obvious scare, fear in this regard is that they just end up as blind admirers and followers of these agitators without any change ever being possible on their part. I'll just share one small example here. Last year, some JNU students thought that they will commemorate Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in the library of Jawaharlal Nehru University by establishing one small statue of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar on his death anniversary. And it was thought over that the program would take place, establishing the statue, that would take place at the hand of one veteran thinker and entrepreneur, Mr. Milind Kamre, who happens to be the chairperson of DICCY, DICI is an organization which takes care of providing assistance to socially underprivileged youth from socially underprivileged classes for their entrepreneurial training and also for their corporate training and so on and so forth. They also give them financial assistance. Mr. Milind Kabra happens to be the chairperson of DICI. This was the program which some JNU students thought that they would carry out in the library of JNU. Mr. Milind Kabra, as soon as he got up from his chair to make an address to the gathering over there, some JNU goons who are inspired by this ideology, which is so very blatantly totalitarian, in the garb of being liberalist, in the garb of being democratic, they are the ones who are actually being anti-democratic and illiberalist. They did not even allow Mr. Milind Kabra to open his mouth to make an address. They started the hooting and the entire program was stalled by these goons who behaved in an utmost unceremonious manner. And that happened in a university, that happened on the occasion of the death anniversary of such a veteran thinker and social reformer, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, and this happened against Mr. Milind Kabra himself, who represents that identity and who is working constructively for the development of these people, from these youth from the socially underprivileged classes. This is revolutionizing for nothing and changing actually nothing. Where has it come from? Why has our academics come to this effect? Why has our academics come to this sorry state of affairs? Are we really afraid of dissent? Am I sounding as if I'm afraid of dissent and criticism and that's why I'm criticizing those who criticize the systems? Sorry, let me clarify here. We are not allergic to dissent. We are not allergic to vidroh, what we call in Marathi or Hindi. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is an icon of social vidroh. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar did challenge the traditions and he did question the authoritarian classes. He fought against the caste system. And he became the instrument and agent of much desirable positivist social transformation in Indian society. He took our society to a casteless times or casteless consciousness. But Dr. B.R. Ambedkar never ever in his life even listened to the slogans like Tere Tukde Honge, etc., etc. Even Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who experienced the worst of this society, never ever thought in this manner. All his life, you read every single literature, pamphlet, essay, book written by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, he was a nationalist to the core and he did not ever denigrate this very great nation of ours. However, he did question the authoritarian class. He did break the status quo. He did bring in the reformation. These people do their nasty politics in the name of B.R. Ambedkar because they are on the lookout for an identifiable face so that they would be able to launch their anti-Indian agenda by provoking the socially underprivileged classes, especially the youth, and so that they would go against the system, go against the nation, go against the interests of the nation, and eventually they want to realize their own dream, which had so far been an unsuccessful and unfulfilled dream in all over the world. They want to fulfill their own dream of revolution and revolutionizing India and then destroying the traditions, the value system, the indigenous culture of the people of India. I shall not speak in abstract terms of people of the country. It is after all the people of, it is after all the culture of the very people who live out that culture day in and day out every single moment. So it is something very tangible to us. And this cultural politics is too much after destroying that indigenous culture of the people themselves, and they are trying to superimpose the same socialist, communist agenda, the leftist agenda of overwriting the identity of the people of India themselves. I shall come to this particular point. Before that, I would like to also catch your attention to this very agitation drive which took place in JNU on 9th February 2016, 5 p.m. The program was named Cultural Evening. I would like to catch your attention especially to the word cultural. The revolution that happened in China is called Cultural Revolution. And this isn't a coincidence that the JNU students who gave the slogans of Bharat Tere Tukde Honge in a program which was named Cultural Evening, and the revolution that happened in China was named Cultural Revolution. In 1956, a few benchmarks I shall share with you, and through those benchmarks we will try to familiarize ourselves with the trajectory and the path of how this academics was in a very subtle manner introduced in the academics and in the curriculum of humanities especially, and how they also talk about these two words, theory and practice. The images which you saw, these are the specimen of the practice of the theory which they learned in the classrooms. And these are the theories which have been introduced through the tradition of critical theory, through the tradition of cultural studies, and the liberalist studies, and so on and so forth. This JNU incident had this name, Cultural Evening. In 1956, in Birmingham, Stuart Hall, who was a veteran Marxist thinker, a Jamaican by birth, settled in UK. Stuart Hall founded one institute in 1956 in UK, in Birmingham, the Institute of Cultural Studies, the Birmingham Institute of Cultural Studies. My topic today is cultural politics. In my introduction, the placards and the invitation card which you read, in the introduction page, I have put one phrase there while having some discussion with Abu Sheikh Ji before the session started. When I uttered the term cultural Marxism, which is given in that introduction of the invitation card, I would like to reiterate that term unless and until I get this full confidence that I have shared possibly everything which I could have shared with you as far as the significance of cultural Marxism is concerned. Because Abu Sheikh Ji also, when I shared that term with him, he got a bit startled. He said, if it is Marxism, how is it cultural? And if it is cultural, what does Marx have to do with it? Because this gentleman never ever believed into even the presence of culture. He would regard it as something intangible, and that is why unreal, and that is why non-existing. Marxism is a highly materialistic philosophy. You are right. If you found an oxymoron into this term, cultural Marxism, if you found that these two words contradict one another, you are perfectly right to think so, and therein lies the agenda of cultural politics through academics. Yes, I'll come to that. That's an obvious reaction on everybody's part. Communist Manifesto was published in 1848. Those were the days of Industrial Revolution, to cut the long story short. Karl Marx thought that with whatever vision and ideas he had about the modern world, he thought that what he had in his mind would offer some solutions to the social problems that were prevalent in Europe in the second half of the 19th century. Perfect. There was nothing wrong in what he thought. This is not to denigrate Karl Marx as a thinker. My only point of contention is that Karl Marx thought up something and he offered some solutions to the social and cultural and economic problems, social and economic problems that were prevalent into the second half of the 19th century. That was purely in the context of the circumstances and surroundings that got formed in Europe as a reaction and result of the Industrial Revolution, which had become so very rampant in those days. Marx gave a model of revolution. According to Karl Marx, some of it might sound a bit academic and a bit philosophical, but I shall soon come to those issues which are relevant for us as far as this very session is concerned. Because we need to understand this very basic transformation which took place in the framework of communism itself, in the framework of socialism itself. And that is why it is called neo-left. Marx gave a model of revolution called base and superstructure model. According to Karl Marx, economy is the base of everything. Logical enough, industry was growing like anything. Science was getting fully exposed only for the sake of industrial benefit. To the extent that if you are doing science without an industrial benefit, you are not doing science. That is what the West has given us as a vision about science. Economy is the base of everything, Karl Marx, which is why the revolution has to happen in the domain of industrial economy, because workers and the working class population, workers are the exploited and the oppressed ones. Fair enough, that was in the European context. We are not denying that. Marx says, by the way, I would like to catch your attention to one very latent discrepancy in this observation, that he did not really speak about uplifting the life of the working class population so that they would rise and enlighten and live their life happily. Mr. Marx talks about revolutionizing their sentiments, exploiting their conditions, circumstances, situations, so that the socialist ideals would be attained. Please mark this kind of motivation. He was not really, to my best knowledge, he was not really motivated by the sincerest concern to cause an upliftment in the life of these downtrodden classes, especially the working class populations who were the third grade citizens in Europe in those days. His entire motivation was to attain the fulfillment of his own socialist ideals. Okay, fine. Workers are to be exploited for the sake of revolution by antagonizing them against the capitalist classes. May the proletariats of the world launch a revolution against the capitalists of the world. That is why economy is the base of everything, because workers are to be used for revolution. Why? Because there is a clear imbalance between the capitalist and the working class population. Result? No revolution happened, actually. 1848 till 1910, the second half of 19th century and the first decade of 20th century, the world was almost under the influence of Marx's philosophy of revolution. All intellectuals and academicians in Europe, they primarily thought that, okay, this is the beginning of a brave new world and we would have equality everywhere in our society, all over the world, if we work on the principles and ideals of Marx and so on and so forth. The workers of the world did unite, but they did not unite to launch a revolution as per the vision of Karl Marx against the capitalists. They united in the interest of their own nations. And this extreme imperialist nationalism, quote unquote, this extreme imperialist nationalism of the workers and the majority population in Europe went to such an extent that by 1914, it was sheer reason. It was the sheer reason that why did the World War first happen? Thanks to their imperialist nationalism. Don't we know about the age-old enmity that is practiced between England and France? They even fought 100 years wars when there were no technology and no media and no newspapers to arouse your sentiments against the other. 100 years war were fought. Even in France, you are not really appreciated when you try to communicate in the language of a British person. Hollywood movies are banned. They are not shown in the multiplex in France, and they call it as their policy for the protection of the culture of France. Look at the paradox. I mean, I always feel entertained whenever I look at the paradox of Europe at times. France, the same country and civilization which has given us so many so-called liberalist thinkers, and we find such practices being prevalent in France alone. Hollywood movies are not shown in the multiplexes or not at public places. If at all you are crazy after it, go and buy your own DVD and watch it home. Don't make it a public performance. That is what they do in France. The imperialist and the provincial nationalism, which is rooted into ethnic, which is rooted into their sense of ethnic superiority. What did happen in Germany by 1930s? The result was that while people were thinking, especially the intellectual class, philosophers, journalists, artists, all those noble men and women all over Europe and in the entire Western world, while they were thinking that Marxist ideals would help us to reach to the commencement of that brave new world and there would be equality everywhere, what practically happened was exactly in contradiction with what even Marx had thought up. First World War, 1914, the rise of Nazism all through 1930s. These European Marxist intellectuals now thought that it was high time that they involve themselves in a clash with the giant. Goes without saying that the giant was the same philosopher who motivated them to adopt that ideology, and neo-left came into being in 1920s. Frankfurt Institute. The Frankfurt Institute was founded in 1925 by three German philosophers. The Frankfurt Institute of Social Research. The German philosophers who founded, they were Marxist. And they were Jews. I wouldn't have mentioned their religious orientation because that is another provincial practice. But here, for the sake of understanding of our discourse, it is quite desirable. When I say this, I shall repeat it. In the 20s and 30s in Germany, they were Marxist philosophers and they were Jews. And they founded this institute. Not a wonder that they adopted communism as an ideology which would solve their problem, because Nazism was a threat against their own existence there. Please mark it well. I would like to catch your attention again to the fact that this type of academics, which has its root into a particular historical phenomena and circumstances that took place all over Europe, it was all normalized into Indian academics of sociology, political science, history and whatnot in 1990s, and we didn't even question it even once, doubting its authenticity and first of all its relevance. These three philosophers founded that institute and they called themselves neo-left thinkers. Cultural politics of academics begins at this point in Europe. Ever since this institute was founded in Europe, it soon developed amongst the academicians. It soon developed as a sentiment as if a new solution was underway. Because the old left was no longer found to be feasible and tangible and effective and productive, so something new was being desired. These three philosophers brought it into motion by founding that, establishing that institute. This soon caught momentum in most universities all over Europe, and that was the reason why do we find that in most Western European universities, we find that these neo-leftist, neo-liberalist, neo-communist, neo-socialist thinkers, their own books and their own knowledge and their own epistemology which they have produced, how had it become normalized in European universities? The reason is this institute, which was founded way back in 1925, because that was the time when these people, they started refurbishing it, reinventing it. There is a particular word which is used by Theodore Adorno. He says, we have undertaken the task of re-narrativizing Marx. The obvious inspiration behind these words, the obvious inspiration behind these words, Antonio Gramsci, a philosopher and a politician from Italy, in 1920s, Antonio Gramsci fought against, could the name kindly be shared by anyone of you there? 1920s, Antonio Gramsci, who was a founder of Communist Party of Italy, he fought against Mussolini. Yes, I'm sure you gave the answer, but then you were hardly audible. Thanks to my close observation of what you were saying, what you were telling your friends, so I could read that. He fought against Mussolini. Antonio Gramsci was the first neo-leftist thinker who questioned Karl Marx. However, Gramsci makes it clear that I am not rejecting Marx, I am modifying Marx. To be short, to be concise, Gramsci turned Marx's model upside down. Marx had said that revolution has to happen in the domain of industrial economy with the help of workers. So economy is the base, everything else is a superstructure. Gramsci said, no. Dear, it's high time that we wake up to the reality. Economy is not the base. Culture is the base of everything else, and hence the revolution has to happen in the domain of culture. So what happened here? Let us understand. These guys were smart, goes without saying. I'm not denying their intelligence. I'm only questioning the use of that intelligence in the Indian context, in 21st century, in the last 3-4 years, and especially in the last 30 years, since this kind of academics was normalized, as if this could be the only academics which we could practice as Indians. Gramsci said, it is not economy, it is the culture which is the base of everything, and hence the revolution has to happen in the domain of culture. Fine. So what did he do? Everything changes here, right? The base changes. In place of workers, now you have those who are culturally dominated. Gramsci was keen enough also to give the list of those who are culturally dominated. One, women. All over the world are perpetually culturally dominated. Revolution has to happen by sensitizing, provoking the issues concerning existence and position of women, cultural, economic, and so on and so forth. Women, one. Two, all minorities are perpetually, always and forever dominated, oppressed by the majority population. So the revolution has to happen again with the support of the minorities. Three, youth in all the countries of all the times are permanently dominated, oppressed. Their interests are never being taken into consideration by the elderly generations of all the countries. And that is why the revolution has to happen with the support and participation of the youth. First of all, by challenging the same value system which their parents and the other elder members of the family have adopted. Youth. Fourth, socially underprivileged classes. There is a word which was quite fashionable in this particular discourse, and we didn't really mind using that word earlier, but the Honorable Supreme Court also has made some deliberations regarding that, so I shall refrain from using that word. I will leave it to your imagination and understanding. The socially underprivileged classes, the so-called lower caste individuals and communities in the country, revolution has to happen by provoking the sentiments of these four classes, where revolution can't happen with the support of the workers. You know, if you check that history, or even if you just Google it, you will find that post 1950s, trade unions and workers' unions, they actually started withdrawing themselves, and their presence is minimal in the socialist politics of Europe and even in the United States of America. The reason was not that the so-called right wing was getting upper hand over the left wing in Europe and America. The reason was that it was a strategic retreat on their part, because by that time they had shifted their attention from economy to culture. Now, as an Indian, I feel prompted to ask a question here, because these neo-leftists say that by applying the principles of Gramsci and Marx and Lenin and Trotsky and Lukács and Althusser, these are all neo-leftist thinkers, by applying the principles of these people, you can challenge the authority and you can challenge the center of power in terms of cultural power, hegemony, Gramsci says. He has used the word subalterns, the subaltern classes. These four identities which I spoke of right now, he calls them subaltern classes. Subalterns is equal to workers in Marxist jargon. The identities and the categories to whom Marx identifies as workers, and with their help the revolution has to happen, Gramsci says they are subalterns. Change the terminology. People will receive it as something new, something ultra-modern, something contemporary. This is exactly what happened. By that time, these three philosophers who founded that institute, they were expelled during the Nazi regime. They landed at Geneva. The institute migrated from Germany to Geneva. They worked there for 2 years. In 1935, they landed at Columbia University, United States of America. By that time, from 1920s to 1930s, late 1930s, these three philosophers worked in Columbia University. Herbert Marcuse, one of these thinkers who established this kind of academics in Columbia University, he has said this on record, that the times in the US in 1930s are not adequate for us to introduce Marxist philosophy with the name Marxist studies. So we need to adopt a politically correct strategy to introduce these kinds of studies. So two words, two terms, phrases were devised. One was critical theory, another was cultural studies. So very academics when it sounds, when you speak of it, and so very blatantly and destructively political when you actually learn it, practice it, live it out, and so on and so forth. They worked there till 1951. By that time, whatever worse could have happened to Germany had happened, so they returned to Germany in 1951. Frankfurt Institute of Social Research was now made into Frankfurt University. From 1920s till 1960s and 70s, Google it. Just type 1960s and 70s in US and in Europe. You will get a list of agitations and protests and drives and youth culture and subculture movements which practically worked in the same manner in which they are working now in India in the last 3-4 years. Nothing happens without a cause. And that is my point of contention. These people are not even being original and creative in forwarding their dissent and criticism of the system. They are only incorporating the way in which the American nations or the American states, the way in which the European nations lived out and practiced these agitations. They are not being original, and worst of all, they are not being genuine about their motives. They only want to revolutionize the scenes. And academics is the tragic trajectory through which this is being ensured. Globalization came 1960s, 70s and 80s all over Europe and America. This went on. I shall not enter into the details. You can generally check and do your own research along these lines. I will only share one example. One most massive agitation drive which happened in United States of America in 1967. It actually dragged 15 lakh American college boys and girls on the streets to challenge the authority of the President of United States of America. I am not being sympathetic here to the political leaders of America that they were challenged by these agitating boys and girls. My only point of contention is, how is it that this mode of dissent, how is it that this style and methodology of criticism of the system becomes so very obvious through Indian academics for the Indian issues? I am not even making any provincial statement as a blind observer and a lover of my nation that India does not have social issues or there are no social evils in our country. We do have. But as an Indian, I would also like to ask a question here. Show me the country other than India which did have some social evils in their country and they had to incorporate the solutions for their social problems from any other nation, from any other civilization in the world. Is this the price of colonization that we have to still pay after so many years? Would colonization or the hangover of colonization be so very destructive that it would not even allow to think, it would not even allow us to think of the solutions to our own social problems? That is my point of contention. Look at progressivism, for example. Why is it, otherwise progressivism is such a nice word, it is such a nice concept, but progressivism, those who love the culture of their country, they question progressivism. Those who are on the side of progressivism, they hate culture. Why this dichotomy? Why this binary? Why this duality? Can't culture and progressivism go hand in hand? Can they not reach at a meeting point when progressivist minded people also become culturally sensitive and they offer some such progressive solutions to the social evils and problems in our country which people would find identifiable and justifiable at large? At least such solutions would not end up as non-feasible solutions, and that would be a real path of social reformation in our country. You know, the worst disadvantage and the worst destruction that has happened because of this left-centric academics of humanities in our country, it has neither helped us to educate ourselves, it has nor helped us to reform our society. We have been learning it as, you know, something which is called in English studies as rote learning. We are only learning those theories, we are only making them by heart and we are writing answers about them, we are writing papers and assignments and presenting them in conferences, but nothing of that is getting transferred into feasible social solutions to eradicate all those age-old problems of culture and society which we have been facing. The reason is, which was stated by the Honorable Chairman of the session, that our policies and our theories are not on the road on which they should be. The youth, the young people especially present here, they have heard the name AIB. I shall not give a full form of AIB. Tanmay Bhatt and Guru Simranjit Khamba, they are the postgraduates in cultural studies from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. What they did a couple of years ago, by doing the image morphing of the most revered and ever adorable Lata Mangeshkar and Sachin Tendulkar, what they did in the form of image morphing, those of us who do not know what was that incident actually, they made the image forming of Lata Mangeshkar. A still photograph is used and then it is used as a video and then some, with some animation technique, the lip movement is shown. And these two guys had the audacity of putting the most vulgar and obscene words and statements in the mouth of Lata Mangeshkar and Sachin Tendulkar. So when you see that face on the screen, the impression is created that it is Lata Mangeshkar who is speaking up this trash, this nonsense. Why do these people do that? What kind of activism is this? What kind of agitation is this? And they call themselves stand-up comedian? The 15 lakh young boys and girls in America who had come on the streets of United States, Chicago and Illinois, the march was carried out.
They were organized by the stand-up comedians in United States of America. Tanmay Bhatt and Guru Simranjit Khamba, they are so bankrupt intellectually that they can't even show their originality in criticizing the authoritarian classes over here. Look at the subservient condition of their own mindset. They have to depend even for dissent on what keeps coming from the other countries and other civilizations and so on and so forth. Both of them did post-graduation in cultural studies from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Guru Simranjit Khamba, who is the founder of AIB, he had taken stand-up comedy as the project assignment topic for his second year of post-graduation. This is not happening without any reason. There is a trajectory, there is a path, there is a system, there is an agenda, and this agenda is being silently worked out and executed and implemented through our academics. 1990s was a busy period of globalization. We grew up industrially. We were busy making money. There is hardly any third world country which exposed itself to this market-centric globalization, which did not have to experience this cultural after effects, this destructive cultural after effects of globalization, of the market-driven globalization. We are currently going through that stage, and that is why I call them the cultural, the market-driven globalization, and these are the cultural after effects, the destructive cultural after effects of this market-driven globalization. Post-1990s, this kind of academics was introduced into Indian universities. Christ University set the motion, and this is how it got proliferated all over the country, and this is how it is motivating the people, it is motivating the youth of our country to agitate. We are okay if they agitate against the state. We are okay if they agitate against the government. We are not being the supporters of the government here. Whichever party comes in power or rules, if there is something about its methodology and governance which has to be criticized, then every citizen has the right to criticize it. So this is not to say that their criticism of the government is wrong. Why Bharat tere tukde honge? This is not an anti-government criticism. This is not an anti-state dissent. This is an anti-civilization and anti-Indian dissent, which clearly means that the agenda is to transform destructively the indigenous value system of the people of India and to superimpose the socialist value system. Mr. Stuart Hall, who founded the Birmingham Center of Cultural Studies in 1956, has explicitly written this in his essay, Theoretical Legacies of Cultural Studies, that, I'm quoting Stuart Hall, "As of now, we do not want to occupy the political space. Our aim is to occupy the cultural space. We are currently going through that phase, that the cultural space is being occupied by these people and they want to transform this value system." There is a lot about it which could be talked. As I said earlier, the issue is quite vast and one can't really sum it up in a short span of time. But then one can't really go on speaking everything. I shall leave the rest to your imagination and understanding. In the end, I would like to share something, an observation in this regard, which is actually a sharing. I'm too young and too inexperienced to present myself in the position of somebody who could offer a solution directly and readily to all these issues. But as an Indian, and as a teacher, and as a student of language and literature, I'll only say this here, that darkness does not have its own identity.
Even in the physics terms, we define darkness. It could be defined as the absence of light. The absence of Indian sensibility in the academics of humanities and social sciences is darkness. This darkness does not have its own existence. It is not independent. This darkness has formed because of the absence of Indian consciousness and Indian reality into the academics of humanities. Let us hope and pray to the Almighty, and not just hope and pray, but let us commit ourselves to some active work in this regard, so that this darkness of an anti-Indian cultural politics would fade away, and that would be the beginning, and that would be the dawn of Indianness being incorporated into our academics of humanities, so that our future generations would know India, that is Bharat, as their own country, which they learnt about from their parents, and not only through the academic deliberations which were made by these biased academicians. Thank you very much.